And one of them is the former Shadow Foreign Affairs Minister, Stephen Doughty. And as I'm saying, very good afternoon to you, Mr. Doughty.
Good afternoon.
Your resignation gave Mr. Cameron a lot of ammunition to throw at your leader. Was your timing deliberate?
No, not at all. I had just come to a decision this morning based on the sacking of my colleague Pat McFadden for very reasonable and right comments about terrorism and national security, that given that I held those views as well, that it was only honourable for me to step away from the front bench as well.
But, I mean, let's look at the overview. Mr. Corbyn is the leader, as we're oft told, by a thumping majority. Isn't it within his rights, within your party, to fashion the front bench in his own image, to have people who won't be disloyal?
Well, leaders always reshuffle, but I think the question of disloyalty, I think, is one that's extremely misleading. Pat McFadden has served loyally under a number of Labour governments and in opposition, has been one of our most effective ministers and shadow ministers, and is a man held in high regard by colleagues in all parts of the party. And singling him out for his very reasonable views on such a serious matter as national security, I think, is extremely regrettable.
Well, I mean, it wasn't just that, was it? I mean, you say he was loyal. Well, I did an interview with him last year when he talked about how Labour was becoming, or he hoped Labour wouldn't become, a protest group under Jeremy Corbyn.
Well, I think a lot of things were said during the leadership election about people's
afterwards.
Views on the future of the party
afterwards, Mr. Corbyn was well installed as leader, Pat McFadden as Shadow Europe Minister, came on my programme on a Sunday and gave me a lengthy interview about Labour turning into a protest group.
Well, I think one of the things that impressed me about Jeremy and why I agreed to serve on the front bench in the first place was his willingness to have honest and frank discussions and that straight talking, honest politics, which I took at face value. And certainly, you know, I have great agreement with Jeremy on a whole series of issues: tax credits, climate change, tackling the Tory trade union bill, which I was pleased to lead our opposition to in the Commons. But also, we've got to have the ability to have a frank and free discussion about matters, and not to play internal party politics or indeed cross party politics with matters like national security and defence. And I think it's only right, when I have the same views as Pat on those issues, and would have said exactly what he said in the Commons that day about terrorism and tackling the narratives about the West, that it's the honourable thing for me to do, to step away too.
So you've got to turn that round then, the narratives there and blaming the West and Western foreign policy and motivating terrorists. You've got to turn that round then. So you and Pat McFadden believe that the leadership of your party actually subscribe to that worldview?
Well, no, I don't. And I actually criticised David Cameron directly in the Commons chamber in the Syria debate about his disgraceful use of the term terrorist sympathisers. But at the same time, I've criticised Jeremy directly about his associations with the Stop the War coalition, which I think have said absolutely unacceptable things following the Paris attacks. And I think it's regrettable that, that him and his office have continued to associate with that organisation.
Well, that's right. Well, then he does subscribe to that worldview, doesn't he? I mean, he hasn't disassociated himself with it, and it was on their website, wasn't it, Stop the War coalition, that some terrorist attacks are as a result or related to Western foreign policy actions.
Well, no, actually, in his own words, Jeremy did disassociate himself from those comments, and indeed he did a very dignified and honourable thing following the Paris attacks in laying wreaths at the embassy. But I don't think it's appropriate that the party continues to have associations with that organisation, which, let's remember, Carolyn Lucas, Peter Tatchell and others have separated themselves from because of their views. And whatever its role it might have played in opposing the Iraq war in 2003, unfortunately, it has taken on a whole series of individuals and positions that I simply can't support. As I said, fundamentally, this comes down to very, very serious matters of national security and defence and others. And given that I hold the same views as Pat on what he said about narratives around terrorism, and he's been sacked for that reason, I think it's only the honourable thing to do for me to step away as well.
Pat McFadden also said he hoped that the reshuffle wouldn't be petty and divisive before it happened. Do you think it's turned out that way?
I think aspects of it have done it, yes. I think it's extremely regrettable that mistruths are being briefed out from the leader's office just this morning. And I think that's really regrettable, particularly when it's about long-serving and hard-working members of both previous Labour governments and also in opposition. And individuals like myself who took the decision to serve, despite, you know, having honest differences with Jeremy and others about some key matters, thought it was in the best interest of the party and an effective opposition to do that. But in the end, it comes down to a matter of conscience, and I certainly couldn't, after what happened in the last 24 hours, continue in my role, given that Pat had been singled out in that way.
Yeah, you talked there about individuals like myself, so there are a lot of others.
Well, there are a lot of individuals who clearly have concerns about aspects of Labour policy, you know, and also have differences. And actually, we've always been a broad church, and a lot of that debate is conducted in a very comradely and friendly manner, and as it should be on matters of such seriousness. But when mistruths are being put out about individuals, and when we're playing internal party politics essentially with matters of national security, then I don't think that's the way that we should be headed. Mm. I've always believed that these issues should go well beyond party politics, and certainly beyond internal party politics and the politics of individual score settling.
Well, I mean, what's your estimate about the number of your colleagues who think along your lines, that think that Mr. Corbyn and his acolytes have made this petty and divisive?
Well, I think there are a number of colleagues who have serious concerns about what's happened in the last 24 hours. I mean, I'm not going to give a number. I mean, it's for individuals in themselves to speak up about their concerns and to take their own decisions. I can only make decisions for myself, and I felt it was the honourable thing to do to step away, given that I agreed with everything that Pat had said in the statement that he has been sacked for.
How do you think Mr. Benn is going to conduct himself, staying in post as Shadow Foreign Secretary? But we all know, the dogs in the street know, he's been muzzled.
Well, as far as I understand, that's absolute nonsense, and I'm sure Hillary would say the same, and I'm sure he's going to speak out on a series of issues in exactly the way he would have before. Hillary is an extraordinarily principled and long-standing figure in the Labour Party, and I'm sure he's going to continue to be that way, just as he was in the debate over Syria.
If he'd been moved or sacked, what would have happened?
Well, I think a significant number of individuals would have left their front bench roles. And as it is, a number are choosing to leave their roles anyway. But, you know, the threats and the kind of machinations that have been going on for weeks now, when really we should have been focusing on the Tory government's failures over flooding, the chaos over the EU referendum. You know, on a very day that we saw great divisions in the Tory party, we had a reshuffle lasting, you know, for hours and hours and hours, and then some quite divisive moves at the end of it.
How do you think Mr. Corbyn comes out of all this? Do you see him as a Prime Minister?
Well, Jeremy Corbyn is an extremely principled and pleasant individual. I mean, I've had personally no problems with Jeremy on a personal level. He's always been extremely courteous to me. We have very clear disagreements on a whole series of issues, and I think Jeremy is principled and mature enough to be able to cope with that kind of disagreement. I think what's regrettable is some of the operation around him that is continuing to undermine colleagues, that is continuing to breathe out complete untruths to the media, whilst at the same time telling us that they're talking about straight and honest talking politics. You know, that's a complete you know, contradiction in terms, and it's got to stop. Until that happens, I think it's going to be very difficult to find the sort of unity that all of us want to see in the Labour Party.
Yeah, but the question was about, do you see him ultimately as Prime Minister? We're talking about the internal workings of the Labour Party. Now, the public are watching, and eventually Mr. Corbyn has to reach out to them to try to become Prime Minister.
Well, Jeremy was elected with a huge mandate, and he has absolutely the right to put that forward before the country. And now we've got key elections this year, obviously, in May. You know, we're all out speaking to voters every week. You know, a number of them are very pleased with a whole series of things that Jeremy's been doing, and particularly the work we've done in tackling the plans to cut tax credits and cut the police issues that would have affected my constituency massively. Jeremy has my wholehearted support on those, and he was absolutely right to take the positions that he did. But there are also areas where clearly the public have concerns, and you know, a number of those are around national security issues, and you know, I want to hear a much clearer affirmation from the leadership of the Labour Party around these issues, and as I said, stop associating with organisations that appear to equivocate over those, such as Stop the War Coalition.
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it sounds to me as if you're saying in an elegant way, as it stands with that particular policy, you're unelectable.
Well, I speak with my own words. I don't need them put in my mouth too much. But no, I think there are a whole series of issues that we have to set out. We're very early in a parliament, and we're well away from a general election. And we clearly have a number of key tests this year, but fundamentally those will be fought on local issues in Wales. We've got an excellent First Minister in Carwyn Jones and an excellent Welsh Labour government that has continued to deliver on its promises and has protected the Welsh people from serious harm when it comes to health and education and some of the reforms that we've seen in England. And I'm going to be really proud to be standing on a platform of fighting for a Labour victory in Wales in May.
Just hearing your colleague Kevin Jones has also resigned, followed your lead. I mean, is this coordinated? Have you talked to Mr. Jones?
I mean, I speak to a number of my colleagues all the time, and you know, Kevin's a close colleague. You know, individuals have to take their own decisions about these matters. I certainly did this morning. My colleague Johnny Reynolds has obviously decided to go for his own reasons as well. In the end, this comes down to a matter of conscience and personal views. And I certainly felt that as a colleague of mine, Pat McFadden, in the same team, foreign affairs team, who I'd worked with very closely, somebody who I respect immensely, given that I have the same views as him that he'd been sacked for, I felt it was only the honourable and right thing for me personally to step away. What other individuals decide to do is up to them.
But presumably you wouldn't be surprised if a few more follow your lead.
Well, there are a number of individuals with concerns, but whether or not that leads to their resignations, as I said, is a matter for them. I can only speak for myself. I felt it wasn't honourable for me to stay, given the concerns that I had. I'd hoped to be able to stay, but unfortunately, the way that things were handled over the last 24 hours meant that I couldn't.
Just want to return to the issue of Mr Corbyn. You didn't quite answer that. Is he excellent? You said your Welsh leader is excellent. Is Mr Corbyn?
Well, I think there are concerns about the way that the Jeremy's leadership operation works and the way his office conducts itself. And I think those are concerns that are going to have to be addressed, in order to bring out, I think, the best aspects of what Jeremy has to offer. I thought it was extremely disappointing, for example, that on a day when we'd had such significant victories about tax credits and about police cuts, that the media coverage for the day was dominated by John McDonnell's waving of Mao's little red book. Those are the sorts of errors and perceptual issues that I think, quite frankly, need to be addressed, because they're overshadowing very, very real wins that we've had on a series of issues. I want us to be focusing on those. You know, as I said, we should have been focusing on the EU divisions in the Conservative Party and the unity in the Labour Party on that issue. And instead, of course, it's all been thrown off.
But, I mean, you know, you go on around about the team around Mr Corbyn and Mr McDonnell, you go on about the foot shooting, the missed opportunities to hold the government to account. I mean, surely you must then believe the party, your party, would be better off if you had a different team at the top.
Well, there are individuals, I think, need to reflect on the way that they're conducting themselves in Mr Corbyn's office and elsewhere. And ultimately, you know, it's a decision for him how he decides to handle the makeup of his top team. You know, there are individuals in every Labour leader's office who, I think, at different points have caused problems. We all know
about
that.
So he's a prisoner. Do you think Mr Corbyn's a prisoner then of those around him? I mean, the other view is that he's appointed them, his special advisers and others, and he wants them there.
Well, I think Jeremy, I don't know the internal workings of his office on a daily basis, but I would like to see him challenging some of the behaviour that's been going on, certainly in the last 24, 48 hours, and some of the mistruths that are being put out this morning, because I don't think it fits with Jeremy personally. It's not the kind of Jeremy that I know. I've not heard him utter these types of things about people before. Obviously, he can have, you know, cross disagreements with individuals over issues, as does any leader, but I've not heard him engage in these type of things. And I think, I would hope that his team reflected that kind of principled behaviour that he engages in.
But if it continues this way, I mean, you wouldn't be sad to see him saying, I've had enough and let someone else have a go.
Well, there's no prospect of any kind of leadership election or anything like that at the moment.
Well, he can walk.
You know, Jeremy was elected with a significant mandate. It's one of the reasons that I agreed to serve, despite my disagreements with him on a number of issues. And unfortunately, I felt that I had to step away in the last 24 hours because of the handling of this specific issue. But, you know, I'm going to continue to support him in those key areas, that I've mentioned, you know, and our fights against the way that the Conservatives are running the economy, the way they're dealing with the welfare system, tackling climate change globally, tackling cuts in the police service. You know, these are crucial issues. Fighting the trade union bill, which is going to do so much damage to workers up and down this country. Those are issues on which there's complete unity between myself and Jeremy and many across the Labour Party. And I hope it's those issues we can get back to focusing on in the days ahead.
OK, we'll end it there. Thank you very much indeed, Mr Doughty. Stephen Doughty there, the former Shadow Foreign Affairs Minister, as you heard.